is so stupid, it's positively brilliant. The brilliant is
Yep, Charlamagne the God.
Andrew Schulz.
We are the Brilliant Idiots, back for another week of Brilliant Idiot shit. COVID cases are rising.
That's what I hear. Okay. Bro. You think they're shutting it down again?
Listen, I heard today whoever's on Biden's task force, coronavirus task force, said that 6 weeks will get us right back where we need to be.
6 weeks of
lockdown. So 4 to 6 weeks of lockdown, which we could have done way back when, you know, but Americans don't have no fucking discipline.
Can people do it, though?
Americans don't have no fucking discipline. 4 to 6 weeks. You know what it is, man? And this is America's problem. They got to start thinking about the conditions of people who don't live lavish.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Imagine you live in a one-bedroom apartment in New York. Who the fuck? And you got four people living there. 4 to 6 weeks?
Yeah.
You ain't going to make it.
Yeah.
Like, you're not going to make it.
Yeah, people don't realize the effects of it.
No! It's like, oh yeah, stay home. Have you seen my house? Do you know where I live, you motherfuckers? You know what I'm saying? Easy for you to say stay home, Ellen. You know what I mean? I'd stay in your house too. Can I stay at your house for 4 to 6 weeks? Let's trade.
That was what was so annoying about those celebs saying we're in this together. It's like, it don't look like it.
Nah.
You look alone on your estate.
No. We're not in this together. In this together is when you got them friends. Like, I was talking to the homie last night, and he was like, yo, when you come out here, just stay out here, man. But he was like, when you come out here, just stay out here. You know what I'm saying? And he was like, I got five bedrooms. You know what I mean?
He invites you to Mar-a-Lago?
No. It's just somebody in Cali. But it's just the principle. It's just like, it's a different level. You know what I mean? You can't just tell motherfuckers stay home.
Yeah.
Could you stay home before the 6 weeks, Taylor, with your boyfriend?
Yeah. My house is set up. Yeah.
Okay. Well, that's different. Wait a
minute. Only five bedrooms?
Five bedrooms is a lot.
Not a lot of bedrooms, bro.
Yes, it is.
Five bedrooms? I mean, like, five bedrooms?
And one for one person?
I'm just saying, like, if you got it like that, five bedrooms is not that much, bro.
Depends,
like, five bedrooms. If you really got it like that, like, I thought we were talking about bougie.
How many bedrooms you got?
I got a bedroom, you know what I mean? Like, it is what it is, bro.
Imagine having 10,000 square feet.
Say what?
You got 10,000 square feet, five bedrooms. Bedroom's pretty, you cooling out.
I guess, yeah. Man, maybe you got a little pool house or something. I might come through, but I got to be in the same house as you.
Like, you might not see him.
I'm not a child, bro. I need a wing of a house, or I need like a pool house.
Who was I talking to the other day?
My own key.
When we had 2 Chainz on this morning, I told 2 Chainz that because 2 Chainz was sitting in his Rolls Royce outside, you know, doing the interview. And I was like, why are you sitting in the car? And he's like, because the kids in there doing the homework. I'm like, yo, you got 100 acres as big as your house is?
Yeah.
He was like, yeah, but, no, he actually said this. He was like, yeah, but, you know, I got 100 acres and, you know, the house, the Wi-Fi is like the Wi-Fi shit. But that's what you're paying for in the country.
No, dude.
I wouldn't give a fuck. Give me the 100 acres in that big ass house. Who cares about Wi-Fi?
They got Wi-Fi on the moon, bro. They can get you Wi-Fi in Atlanta or wherever he's from. Where's he from?
Atlanta. ATL, Southside.
Oh, that's crazy, dude. How is 2 Chainz?
He's great. His album comes out tomorrow, So Help Me God, on Friday. It's actually a really good album because that whole album is based on his time in quarantine. You know what I'm saying? So it's just a lot of things that he's talking about that I can relate to. Like, his first single is Quarantine Thick.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? A lot of motherfuckers done got quarantine thick.
Yeah, they got wax scan a little
25, 30 at least.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Some people look light, but they heavy though.
Can we call guys thick?
Yeah. You should.
You can call a guy thick.
He's thick.
Be like, damn, you look thick, bro. Like,
Charlamagne, look how happy.
I like it. It's a compliment.
So if a guy says to you, like, damn, Charlamagne, you thick.
Yeah, good looking out. Thank you, man.
That's
it? You notice.
And what if they give you that handshake, but they take the middle finger and they go like that?
That's sexual harassment.
That's sexual.
Don't disrespect my wife. Why are you doing that?
That is true.
Don't disrespect my wife, my G. You know what I mean? Look, but don't touch. This thickness is a no contact sport. All right? Okay, you can observe me all day long.
Window shop,
baby. Come on, enjoy this thickness from afar.
So right. You could take thickness as a compliment from a dude. That's nothing for you. You're into that.
I don't care. But none of that stuff fazes me. Charlamagne, you handsome, you thick. I get that all the time.
Man, ain't nobody saying
that. Yo, Charlamagne, you like Mars Chestnut? Thank you, my dude. Appreciate you. You know what I'm saying? I like it's all the same to me. It's nothing.
Yo, what's the best gay line that you got? What's the best gay pickup line you got?
The best gay pickup line. I never had a gay pick. Oh no, 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 no.
All right, go.
Back in the day, in the MySpace era, I definitely had a basketball player shoot their shot. A basketball player. He was like aggressive, and this one LeBron used to play for the Cavs, mm-hmm. and so they were playing the Cavs, okay. and he was like, "Y'all give you tickets, you know what I'm saying? Have you sit in the section with my family?" And it's like the first time he offered, I couldn't make it. Second time he offered, I told him I was gonna come, but I didn't go. And he hit me on some like
he was sour.
That's disrespectful, you know what I'm saying? Me. Like, damn, yo. And he said like, you know, you stood me up. I'm like, stood you up. And and one of the messages was like, yo, he's like, yo, we gonna go out after, we gonna get drunk. He's like, yo, we get drunk. Like, we get crazy. He put crazy. I'm like, all right. And then his sister pulled up to the station one day. I didn't know who she was. She was just waiting outside. And she was like, yeah, such and such been trying to reach you. You know what I mean? He said, you've been kind of ignoring him, whatever, whatever. And I'm like, this is weird.
Yeah.
And then his sister started acting like she was hitting on me. And so I went over her crib one night and wouldn't touch her. And she was like, wait till I tell such and such this. And I'm like, so he gonna really think I'm gay and confused.
Wait a minute. So she shot her shot.
I don't know what she was doing. I don't know what this was that they had going on. That was some like, and you gotta think I was new to this. So I had just got work. I started working on Wendy in 06. So like, you know, in your mind, between Wendy putting all of this stuff in my head about what the industry is and what people do in the industry, and then having something like that happen, I'm like, what the fuck is going on?
Yeah, they were chasing cheeks, bro.
They were chasing the cheeks. They were chasing the
cheeks, but like the sister was chasing cheeks and the brother.
I think the sister was just trying to see what was up.
That's a little like handsome.
Because if I'd have got with the sister, she'd be like, nah, he's not gay. That's what I think.
She tries to see if you're gay or not.
That's what I think.
So she tried to blow it up and you were like, no, thank you. I'm not into it. Why does she kind of favor him a little in the face?
How come what?
How come you didn't?
Because I'm not a whore, Taylor.
But also was she kind of bustardo?
I don't even know what that means, but by your context, I think it's ugly.
Yeah, but I would never say ugly, but I would say bustardo.
Cosmetically challenged? Nah, she's actually fly.
She was fly. And you said no to some top from a fly?
I've never been that type of person. Like, I'm not a slut.
Huh? No, you're not a slut, but maybe you get a dick suck.
Nah. Did nothing.
On
did
the
nothing.
Casual?
We did nothing.
Really?
She showed me her tatas, and I was like, nice.
So she just busted out the titties, and then you said...
Those are nice.
You said those are nice.
Didn't even touch
objectively
them?
Speaking.
Nope. Didn't touch them.
Did nothing. She approach you with the titties out?
No. Just on some like sensual, like, let me take this off.
Oh, it's a little hot here. And then
boom. Like someone of those. I'm like, oh. So I think it actually started with a conversation because her breasts aren't real.
So she's they weren't real. You want to see these fake tits?
Yeah, it was something like that. And she whipped them out. And I'm like, oh, nice. And then you know, she flirted a little bit and I didn't want to do nothing. And she was just like, wait till I tell such and such this.
Really? Yeah. Interesting. Like did like you not have a condom? Was that why?
Like, it was on drugs. Yeah, no. Taylor, it was sound like a dream I had.
Yeah.
How's my life a dream you had?
Oh, don't get me into dreams I had, bro.
But you were just saying, like, I seen that. Maybe it was a TV show.
Maybe you just had deja vu just now.
Yeah, maybe.
Yeah, that's all deja vu.
I had a little nocturnal emish recently.
What is that? When you dream and have a wet dream?
I had a little nocturnal emish.
Ooh.
Yeah.
Do tell.
Premature ejaculation.
In your dream?
In my dream.
At least you're not disappointing nobody.
At least I'm not cheating. Yeah, I'm saying you boy faithful in the dream world too. You know what I'm saying? That is the ultimate hezzy.
That is ultimate hezzy, yo. That shit'll make you wake up feeling good about yourself.
Damn
like,
right.
You turn to your wife like, you won't believe what this chick tried to do to me in my dream.
I hand her the underwear. I was like, you gotta clean this. Look how faithful I am. I can't be cleaning my own faithful ass underwear. Someone else gotta do this job,
if you just suck my dick the night before like I asked you to.
That's it. Simple.
Yeah.
Yo, your boy hit that nocturnal emish though.
That nocturnal emish be hitting though.
Yo, that shit.
I ain't had one in a long time.
Oh, me neither.
Back in the day, that nocturnal emish used to burn a little bit though.
Really?
Yeah, because you know why? Because you wearing boxes and you be under the sheets.
Okay, so I think it got hot.
No, I think you bust off and it goes back in a little bit.
Was this when you had your skin bridge?
No, it's before the skin bridge. No, after the skin bridge.
After the skin bridge. Yeah. Interesting. Yeah, it never was hot for me.
Because you got to think, it ejaculates.
Yes, it does.
So it shoots out.
Yes.
You never think about it. Like, imagine if you covered that. Like, cover it. I mean, I'm sure somebody out there has done it.
I used to pinch the tip when I was about to bust back in the day.
Really?
Yeah.
Imagine covering it and trying to hold it.
Yeah.
So I think what happens is it comes out, but when it hits the sheet, so a little bit just seeps back in. And it just burns a little bit.
Interesting. Luckily, I was sleeping dick on belly, and I was on my back. So I think it just shot up.
Yeah. So you shot. Oh.
Yeah.
Ended up on your stomach?
A little bit on the tummy, a lot on the underwear.
Nice night, man.
Yes, Taylor.
What was the dream?
What was the dream? I was just in the middle of the street, and there was some girl who I don't know who it was. It was completely random.
Seducing you in your dream.
And she wouldn't even seduce me. She was just talking, and I was just like, oh, I'll keep doing that. And then when I felt like I was about to bust, you know that moment where you think you're about to bust, and then there's a second for you, you're like, oh, there's no going back? In that moment, I leaned in, bro. In that moment, I leaned in, and I just touched her elbow, and then I just fucking ripped one.
Listen, there's nothing there's nothing like that beg for mercy, man.
What's that?
What you just described, know it's no going back.
Yeah, yeah.
And you just got to submit yourself to this woman, and you just got to say, look, you got me. Yeah. I can't control it no more.
Do you start thinking of the excuse during that time? Or do you, you know what I'm saying? are you going? Are you cooking up the reason why you busted so quick before it even shoots out?
I already know the reason.
What is the reason?
You're amazing.
You are amazing.
This is your fault.
Hey, ladies, you want a compliment? Let us bust quick.
I tell my wife that all the time. This is your fault.
Why'd you do this?
Here looking all sexy, got this beautiful wop. You know what I'm saying?
You see what you do to us?
What am I supposed to do?
I'm supposed to not bust.
Duvall used to have the best one ever. Duvall used to say, if I'm fucking you for hours, your pussy garbage.
Yeah, something.
He's got a point.
True.
You got a point.
True.
Hot 20 minutes, everybody should get what they want.
Yeah, all these girls are like, oh, my man fucks me for 2 hours. Like, that should be a little bit of a concern. Right? Like, for 2 hours?
I agree. What's the problem?
Do they mean, like, with breaks in?
What do you mean, breaks?
Breaks for what? What are breaks?
We're not eating snacks.
You know, intermission, these are rounds, baby.
Yeah, but
what I mean, though, like rounds.
No, they're not rounds.
They're not rounds. This is a street fight,
one and done.
This is a street fight.
We're not one and done.
There's no championship bout. What's the most y'all had sex in a day?
One.
You got to talk age, though.
We were younger.
Yeah, we were younger, baby. Oh, let's go. 12 rounds. Who won it?
Nah, 12 is crazy. But I think a good 12 is crazy. You a crazy dude. You're a sex addict. You got to be an addict. You should be put in prison if you're having sex 12 times a day, bro.
Back in the day, I'd go for hours because I thought that was the thing, right? You thought that, like, making love all night was the shit. You know what I mean? Like, I literally would. I'm talking about hours. Like,
you would have sex for hours without busting.
Yeah, man.
Without busting?
Nah, I would bust, but then I get hard again.
She don't get dry?
Nah, not if you bust in her, it keeps it wet.
No. I mean, not if the sex is good, right? But also back in the day, you thought that was the shit too. Like, you beat it up. You beat it up till she dry, and then it's like, no, bro, it's over. You should have been done like a long time ago. You know what I mean? Like, it was just OD for no reason. Gosh.
Yeah, once a girl, I think, orgasms, I think that it's over. Like,
everybody get this.
Yeah, one or two. If she gets two.
Ooh, you get two, I'm going to sleep.
Yeah,
wait,
exactly.
Wait.
The boy's
y'all
out.
Y'all don't at least count, like, all right, let me get her, like, at least two or three.
Oh, no, I do.
Okay.
I do. Because, I mean,
I make sure she gets one.
That's it?
At least one. What do you mean that's it? That we got to be grateful,
no.
Okay? There's poor starving girls out there that don't even have a single orgasm. No, but if I'm feeling like I haven't been giving her a lot of, like, love and affection lately, then I try to get two out of her.
And plus head.
Or three. Plus head what? Plus
you
I get
give
head?
Her head. No, you give her head.
Yeah.
I start with that.
Every time?
Yeah, yeah.
Nah, that's crazy.
That's how you warm it up, baby.
That's crazy.
You gotta warm it up.
You never warm it up by just, like, you just lick your hand and then put it on the base of your dick and then just let her ride up and down on your dick until it gets wet.
You gotta start off with the mouth action.
Nah, you're crazy, bro.
Get down
every
there.
Single time?
Every single time.
Nah,
get down there, baby. That's the appetizer. Get down there.
What if you guys, did a long walk that day?
Then what?
She hops in the shower?
She's about to be your wife.
Yeah, but I don't care.
No.
She got to go in the shower.
Sometimes you got to show her that respect. Lick through that musk or whatever that is, man.
No. She got to go in the shower.
Wait, she has to go in the shower first for you?
Yo, you wash chicken before you cook it. Black people wash chicken before they cook it. You don't wash pussy before you eat it? That's crazy.
We do wash.
That's crazy.
I'm not saying that's something we do on the regular. I'm just simply saying
there was a whole viral campaign about white people not washing their chicken before we cook it. I'm just washing the pussy before I cook it.
And by the way, women know their body. So women ain't going to let you do that if they got that not so fresh feeling.
Exactly.
Yeah.
So if we've been walking around all day, then maybe we just.
That's right. So
right to the sex.
So men, do yourself a favor. If a woman tells you no, you know what I'm saying? When it comes to going down there and eating out, like she's like, no, let me go just take a shower. Trust her.
All she right? knows.
Unless you got the N95 mask to go down there. Okay. All right. Other than that, leave it alone. All right, let's do some positively brilliant. What a fucking idiot. What did you see this week that was positively brilliant?
Let's talk about Carl, bro. Let's just do it, dog.
My guy, Carl.
Got him, bro.
Can I tell y'all this story? First of all, the reason I called my guy is because I give people the same grace that I would want God to give me. He cheated on his wife. He, you know, is holding himself accountable. As far as I'm concerned, that's between him, his wife, and God.
That's it.
I still don't agree with what Hillsong did as far as firing him and putting 100%. Out the press release. I understand it, you know, now that I have a little bit more context. I just think that there was a way, let him step down, you know what I'm saying? And let him handle that in-house, you know, with his family. Like, there was no reason to publicly embarrass him and shame him in that way.
They had a great opportunity to become incredibly relatable and understanding and live up to their Christianity, which is like forgiving people's mistakes. Like,
yes.
God literally said, we're all born sinners. He sins. Mm-hmm. And to excommunicate him, think about everybody that goes to that church right now that might have been unfaithful. How you think they feel in that church? Welcome.
Yeah.
You think that they want to be shunned?
Yeah.
I don't think they feel welcome. I think that they probably feel like they got to find another church now. I thought it was horrible. And I hate any time religion feels like a business.
Yes.
And when you say fired, it's like, who the fuck are you, bro? It's not a business. God, if you really believe in God is giving you this wisdom to pass on, you can't be firing anybody.
Yeah. And listen, you know what? It triggered me because it brought me back to, you know, I grew up Jehovah's Witness.
Mm-hmm.
And I used to hate when they used to disfellowship people, because what they would do is one of the brothers would get on the stage and he would say, such and such has been disfellowship from the kingdom of Jehovah's Witnesses.
Mm.
And literally the people that were disfellowship, they can still come to the hall, but nobody talks to them.
Mm.
Now, I think that they're allowed to be spoken to outside of the hall. I don't remember. I'm not quite sure. But I just thought that was so whack. You publicly shame the person. And then when the person comes to the hall, nobody speaks to them. Like, you do that to a kid in school, that's bullying.
That's bullying, bro.
You know what I'm saying?
That's bullying,
You do that to a kid in school, you call a kid out, and then nobody in the school talks to him. That kid might kill himself.
Yeah.
And so for me, my dad got this fellowship. And at the time, my dad was dealing with like a lot of alcohol abuse and drug abuse. And I remember standing by the door, listening to the brothers talk to him in the library at the Kingdom Hall, and him explaining to them, you know, that he's got a problem. So when they disfellowshipped him, he never went back. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that kind of turned me off from the Kingdom Hall as well.
Yeah.
So when I saw what happened to Carl, it took me back to that. Like, I feel like in those moments, those institutions, man, that's what they're supposed to bring you in.
Exactly. That's when you need them the most.
Now, step down as pastor, fine.
Yeah, of course.
But don't tell, you don't got to put him on blast and all of this other stuff,
take
right?
Take a leave of absence so you can figure out your shit.
Take a leave of absence so you can figure out his stuff. But
you protecting yourself, bro. That's what that was.
He's holding himself accountable. I'm sorry that that's happening in his household. I hope things work out with him and his wife. Now, what is so funny, and I love sequence, right? So I gotta tell you the sequence of this. This is, let me look and see what night this was. I think this was Saturday night.
Right? I got something else to tell you that you don't know yet, but after you go through, I got you. It's just gonna add to it. It's just gonna
really?
Add to it. Yeah.
Okay. So Saturday night, Carl hits us up.
He sends us a group text.
You know what I'm saying? I'm not going to say all Carl said, but it's just basically like, yo, you know, we love you. Yada, 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 this and that.
Carl apologized. He's like, yo, I'm sorry if I let you guys down.
Yeah, that's what he did. That's what he did. Yeah. He hit us up and he was like, I'm praying for you both, but, you know, I gotta get myself together. Yep. You know, my shit is messed up. I'm just trying to get my life together. Yada, yada, yada. Right? So I go, yo, we love you, my brother. I hate how Hillsong did you, but I will get him the grace I feel like they didn't give you. Carl says, like, oh, I appreciate you. It's been really hard. You know, like, I'm trying to get my stuff together. Here comes Andrew Schulz. For no reason. All capital letters. Islam is the way. So I just put the laughing emoji. Come to find out.
So the next, that night, was literally that night you called me.
No. Because this was, what night was this? Let me see.
I think that was that day and that night you called me.
Nah, bro. This was Saturday.
Oh, okay.
So I called you Tuesday or Wednesday.
Okay, you called me a couple days later.
It's when the paper came out in the Post because the young lady who Carl was cheating with, you know, came out and told her side of the story. Mm-hmm. The reason I died laughing, because she's Muslim. So this asshole, Andrew, didn't know. He didn't know.
I didn't know. It wasn't out yet. Yo, but here's how. Listen. So I literally was just making a joke, right? I was just making jokes like, the dude's Christian. Maybe he needs a new religion now.
Yes.
Islam's going to be accepted. I got no fucking clue. But I get a call from Charlamagne. He goes, you're not going to believe this. I go, what happened? He goes, do you know the girl that Carl cheated with? I'm like, what, someone in the church? He goes, nope. She's Muslim.
Because if you read the article in the New York Post, she's like, you know, her and Carl was sitting in the park and Carl was like, the most beautiful women come from the Middle East, right?
Yeah, yeah, my Muslim unicorn princess.
My Muslim unicorn.
He was saying some wild shit. You know you want that pussy.
I don't know if he really said all of that stuff. The moral of the story is that shit was funny when you connect the dots between that story but Andrew just tweeting, texting in all capital letters, Islam is the way.
Wait for it. Here's the thing. Carl messaged me individually because I hit him up after I heard the news. A few days before, right? And he was like, hey, my brother, I'm sorry I was about to reach out for you. I didn't, you know, message you. Or, you know, this is, you know, some news is going to come out and blah, blah, blah. And I'm sorry, I failed. I'm working on myself right now. All this kind of stuff like that. And I respond to that in all capitals, just between me and him, Islam is the way, right? But here's the thing, right? Right? So look, Charlotte, he didn't say nothing back. Right? He said nothing back. So when he messaged the both of us, I was like, I'm running this joke back. That's a good joke.
That's a good joke. It's a Christian pastor. Yeah. And I put the laughing emoji.
Charlotte gonna find it funny. This joke needs laughs. This joke requires a reaction. And I knew. But now I know why he didn't react in the first place.
Oh my God, man. That's why, and now that I think about it, he texts back, he said something like, yo, Schulz, if you need to do one of them 15 minutes, turn the camera and roast on me. Yes,
I understand it.
And I was like, over infidelity?
Yeah.
Right? But now it makes
sense. Now it makes all sense.
He thought you knew.
Bro, it's too crazy. It's too crazy, dude.
My thing is this, man. Crazy. Listen, yes. And I'm not making light of infidelity. I hate what's going on in that man's household. I come from a family who watched the household get broken up because of infidelity. It's actually one of the reasons that I stopped cheating, you know, 4 years ago. 4 years sober, 4 years clean. That's me. And the reason I stopped doing that is because I didn't want my household to end up the way my mother and father's household ended up, right? So I'm not making fun of that. I know that shit is hard. I used to listen to my mom sit in her room and listen to Lauryn Hill X Factor over and over and be thinking she's the coolest mom in the world because she liked Lauryn Hill, but no, she was actually hurting, you know? So I don't wish that on no woman. But that shit was funny.
That shit was funny.
That shit was funny, man. Yeah. And you know what bugged me out about the young lady?
Did you look at her pictures and were you like, is this home wrecker worthy?
Nah, I didn't even really look at her pictures. I just read her article. I just found it strange that
what
she would try to stand on some type of moral high ground.
Well, yeah. You knew what time it was. I acted like they're taking advantage of it. It's like, you knew the dude was married. You see the ring on his finger?
He told you. She says in the article, I asked him if he was married. He said yes. And they used to have conversations about his wife and how amazing she was. And he felt so guilty about what he was doing to his family. Mm-hmm. So it's just like, and then at the end of the article, she's like, and I hope more women come out. Like, he didn't do anything to you. He didn't manipulate you. He told you exactly what it was. You participated. You don't have any moral high ground to stand on.
Yeah.
Like, he committed infidelity and you assisted.
Why you think that she did it? She just wants some clout?
To be honest with you, I have no idea. I don't know why people do anything that they do nowadays. I don't even know how people's brain works anymore.
Right.
Because she's a co-conspirator. I don't know why. Like, you're no, there's not a married woman alive who feels sorry for you.
Yeah.
Like, he told you he was mad. You know, my homegirl asked him.
He probably hurt her feelings. That's why she came out with
it. But did he break it off? Because in the article,
it had to be.
She was trying to say, like, I wanted to leave so many times.
I don't think none of that matters. The only thing, like, it's just like, all I'm saying is she has no moral high ground to stand on.
Yeah.
None. Like, it takes two people to commit it. Now, if he would have lied to her and been like, yo, I'm not married, or me and my wife having problems, that's a different ballgame. From what I read in that article, he said none of that. He actually told you that I love my wife. She's amazing. I feel guilty about what I'm doing. You continue doing it. To me, that's just like, hey, everybody just be quiet. Everybody just go to their corners and mind their business. Like, nobody needs to be doing no interviews. Yeah. Nobody needs to be putting nobody on blast. It's nobody's fault.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Y'all met each other. Y'all connected. Y'all did what y'all did.
Yeah. Yo, this foul.
What do you mean?
Man, what do you mean?
Say it's no one's fault.
It's Carl's fault.
It's Carl's fault for cheating on his wife. But as far as those two relationships, as far as that relationship with him and that other young lady, that's nobody's fault that they did what they did. They made a choice. They're adults who made a choice.
Okay. Yeah, he shouldn't have cheated.
He shouldn't have cheated.
But at the same time, it's like that Hillsong firing him, that shit really irks me, bro.
Me too, brother.
That shit really irks me.
That's not supposed to happen
in
the church.
That's dog shit. That's some real dog shit thing to do.
I don't like it either. I simply just don't like it. I understand it. I'm not saying that he should still be pastor, but to put out the press release and say he's fired and all of this and that.
To cover your ass?
To cover. And by the way.
That's what they're doing, right?
Yeah. And I hope that all of those other pastors in that church are as perfect as they are pretending to be in this moment.
Mm-hmm.
You know what I'm saying? Because if y'all get caught up, I want to see what y'all do to yourselves.
What happened to the idea we're all born sinners? What happened? I mean, you can't be up there every single week, right? Yeah. And saying, listen, I'm just as guilty of you of sinning, and I'm trying my best to live my life in the image of God, but I'm not capable to because I'm not perfect. Only He is. And then when somebody does something that is imperfect, it is quite common, unfortunately, they get kicked out of the religion that's supposed to be all forgiving.
Yeah,
why the hell he die then? Why Jesus die? For what? For your sins. Apparently not for Carl's.
Yeah.
It's just corny, man, for the church to do it. Maybe there's more information I don't know about.
Or maybe I wanted more context from the church. Like, even if y'all, I can understand y'all wanting him to step down because he's a leader of the church. You know
how about
what
you want him to step down so he can work out?
He can work on himself. That's what I would have wanted to see. Yeah. I would have wanted to see Hillsong say he has fallen short. He'll no longer be pastoring, but we will be helping him through this process. Like, you know, like, where's the forgiveness? Where's the grace is all I'm saying. Like, that's
corny.
I don't like that.
Super corny.
And we live in this world where we're literally asking imperfect people to be held to a perfect standard.
And don't
that
get me wrong.
It's not going to happen. It's impossible.
Our standards are higher for religious folks, right? Especially for pastors and priests. To me, they are.
Yeah, to you. I mean, I totally get why. For me, no, because I know that they're human. I'm about the message.
Yes.
Not the messenger.
I agree with you. Yeah, and I think there's probably a lot of people that might be like feeling as if they should like discredit the help that Carl gave them right now. Mm-hmm. And I don't think you should because one, it could have been before all that. And even if it isn't before all that, it's like you still were helped. The advice that you got was still valuable. It's like sometimes we get advice from people who are doing the exact opposite, but they know more than anyone.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like your therapist don't need to be happy.
Yeah.
They might just need to understand sadness to a level that could help you. Deal with yours.
By the way, if nobody's, if everybody's so-called perfect, you know, all of these people that we've gotten all of this wisdom and philosophy from over the years, all of this stuff is null and void and invalid. Like, is Reverend Martin Luther King Jr.'s words invalid?
Yo.
You know what I'm saying?
That's like, a good point.
I'm just saying, if you've ever been inspired by Bill Clinton, is his words invalid?
Yo, don't be up there quoting Martin Luther King in church.
Or anywhere.
No, especially in Hillsong. I'm just saying, like, if you're pastors of Hillsong, don't be up there quoting Martin Luther King, but then excommunicate one of your guys for creating the same, like, more or having the same moral shortcomings.
That's what I'm saying, man.
Nah, that's
why. Infidelity.
That's
why. And listen, I'm not making no excuses for cheating. I'm not trying to justify cheating. Like I said, I made a conscious decision to stop cheating 4 years ago. So clearly it's something that I understand the severity of. But all I'm simply saying is, God damn, do we throw the baby out with the baptism? Like, I'm just saying, like, God damn, don't throw the baby out with the baptism, man. Like, let's help, like, help the man.
Yeah.
You know, and by the way, help her too.
Yeah.
Bring her in.
Yeah.
Bring her in, because guess what?
That's a new recruit, bro.
And by the way,
flip one.
By the way,
flip one.
She's a sinner. I don't know why women act like if you cheat with a married man, you're not part of the infidelity.
Well, she's also Muslim, so that's a sin too.
I don't know. What is that? What you mean?
She's Muslim. She's not Christian. She's not living a Christian life.
Oh. I don't
know what I mean? Just like I imagine if you're Christian to a Muslim, you're sinning.
Oh, I get what you're saying.
Actually, can you sin? Can you only sin, live a sinful life if you are of that religion? Like, that's actually interesting. Do religions look at other religions as people sinning, or they're like, no, they're following their belief system and they are a pious person?
By the way, what the fuck is sin?
What do you mean by that?
Like, seriously, what is sin? Like, if you're not a religious person, right? Yeah. Take religion all the way out of it. You're just a human being living life.
Yeah.
What is sin? Because lying is a sin.
Yeah.
Cheating is a sin.
Yeah.
According to the Bible, sex before marriage is a sin. Eating pork is a sin. Deuteronomy 14:8.
But that's that Old Testament. That New Testament fixed that shit.
I don't know what the LeBron James version says. All I know is, what is sin? Like, we all fall short as human beings. Like, I need to know who these perfect people are that are going to heaven that have never committed a sin ever.
Well, you don't got to be perfect to go to heaven. That's the beauty of it.
You don't?
Nah, I think, right? You just go, yo, Jesus, my Lord and Savior, and that's it. I'm in.
This shit is confusing, bro. Like, yo, if you cheat, you're going to hell. But then they tell you all dogs go to heaven. Like, what the fuck? You know what I'm saying? This shit is confusing. Like, what the fuck is going on? Like, this shit is confusing out here, bro. Like, I don't know what the fuck to do.
This guy's stupid. Also, who said all dogs go to heaven? That wasn't in Deuteronomy. It's a movie, but a lot of movies say things. Zootopia said a lot of shit. Animals don't get along like that.
I just want everybody to give people grace, man. Give human beings the same grace you want God to give you. If that's too much, just give humans the grace you want other humans to give you.
Yeah.
Like, and I don't look at him just because he's a pastor or reverend or whatever. I promise you, I'm not holding him to no higher moral standard than I'm holding myself to. Or any man for that matter. He's still a man at the end of the day. I don't care how much he reads the Bible. I don't care how much he's into God. And God damn. It's pussy. That shit is hard to resist.
Middle Eastern
and
unicorn.
And I'm not making no excuses for him.
Yeah.
I'm just saying, women are like, that's God's greatest creation, bro.
Yes.
You got to be strong. It should take willpower and it take discipline. That's
Taylor's
all I'm saying.
Taylor's not feeling this part of the conversation, but it's true, Taylor. It's true. That's God's greatest creation.
Now, I've had this conversation before. The reason...
Nocturnal emish. I nocturnal emish. I didn't even touch pussy. I was just thinking about it in a dream.
Bro.
But I'm just saying, if you love your wife so much.
That's true. No, Taylor's right. And that's really what it boils down to. It boils down to love and loyalty. Like, right? Like, I said, 4 years ago, when I was out there cheating, wilding, I was leading with ego. I was a wounded individual. I was hurt. I was looking for things to fill me up. So laying with a bunch of different women made me feel like the man, but that should be short-lived. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
When you start doing the work on yourself and, you know, like, I started going to therapy and I started, like, really, I could feel myself healing. I did not want to lead with ego no more. I didn't have a wounded ego. So I started pouring into myself in a different way. Therefore, I started pouring into my wife a different way. And I did not want to break her heart. That shit is corny when you the guy, you laying up with your wife and you just, it's the mother of your children. You're supposed to be best friend and you lying to her and you going to sleep with her at night. You know what I mean? Knowing all this bullshit that you doing. Like, I personally can't live like that.
Yeah.
It's all about love and loyalty.
Do you think that's what happened to Carl?
What do you mean?
I know we were talking about the phone, but like, you know, this happened during quarantine, right? So all of a sudden he can't do services 4 times on a Sunday. You know, he's got a mythical-like presence in front of these people.
Yeah,
patting him on the back. They're giving him applause.
Yeah.
He's probably filled that void that he's got inside of him. And then all of a sudden, quarantine shuts it down. Nobody out there clapping, patting him on the back. Maybe he didn't even realize that part of his emotional diet was having that applause.
Yeah, you got to get your hallelujahs from somewhere.
Real talk.
All I know is nobody's above sin, whatever the fuck sin is.
That's
and just
facts.
Give people grace, man. Like, yeah. Like, what the fuck? And then everybody pointing fingers like, no, you're the bad guy. Oh, I'm the bad guy. You're the bad person. You're the bad person. All of y'all bad by book definition.
Yeah.
The woman who's cheating with the married man who's cheating.
Yeah.
All of y'all that are judging him because he's a reverend and he's cheating, that don't make it no better just because you work at the porta potty place and you cheat.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? It's all wrong. Infidelity is wrong. It don't matter what you are.
Yeah.
If you're married, infidelity is wrong.
Bro, God's rolling his eyes at this because his whole point was, I told you you're all wrong. Like, do you not pay attention from the beginning? I told you you all sin.
Yeah, I am not going to lie. I do feel like, you know what? Based off that logic, I do agree. That boy, when you absolutely do right, though, God will bless you. God will be like, this motherfucker here
deserves some unicorn pussy.
What the fuck?
What? I think God respects it. Listen, they say God knows our heart, right?
Yeah.
So God knows. And I don't even like to say how hard it is because it's really not hard. I promise you. It's kind of, it's literally like your diet. When you start eating right.
Yeah, that's a great way.
When you yes. start eating right and you cut out the sugars and the carbs and everything else,
first
it's
week,
not hard.
First week, first week's a little difficult. First couple weeks tough.
It's all about discipline and changing your mindset. So it's not hard. I don't want people to think that. It's just that, yes, women are very beautiful. You know what I'm saying? And it's always slight temptation.
It's also don't put yourself in that position.
That's true also.
What's the position?
Missionary.
Don't put yourself in that situation. Like you went to go meet her. Like, you mean like.
Nah, they met at a prayer thing in the park.
Yeah, that's fine.
Yeah.
But
why you Muslim coming to the Christian prayer thing?
Imagine you just finished saying a prayer and then you open your eyes and there's this beautiful woman just sitting there.
Just sitting there.
God works in mysterious ways.
Mm-hmm. Praying in doggy style.
I'm just saying.
Yo, that's another thing people don't realize, bro. All
right. We just wish the best for everybody involved in the situation. Woo! Oh, this guy is so crazy. What else we got? Positively brilliant. What a fucking idiot. Dave Chappelle on SNL.
What'd you think?
No. It's Dave. You know what I'm saying?
It's not funny.
No, I'm not going to say that. Then Taylor jumps out the window.
She does, bro.
Damn.
Taylor comes out swinging.
I thought Dave was Dave. Yes. I don't know what I call Dave anymore.
Yo, my boy Robbie just said it brilliantly. He's like, now Dave is a speech giver. And he's going to give brilliant speeches. He's going to have like poignant observations. And he's going to say things that we all feel, but articulate them in ways that nobody else can. But his first priority, it appears... isn't packing it with punchlines, but mm-hmm. rather like packing it with nutrition.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like amazing at it.
But those are the best comics to me though. Like, yep. and honestly, I think Dave has always been like that. I think Dave-
He just had more like silliness and punchlines early on.
Everything you've ever watched Dave do has always been a message behind it.
Facts.
The Chappelle Show was the same way. Like, even though it was funny, there was always a broader message in it.
Yep.
And that's what I get from him doing SNL. Like, it's just, the way he's able to captivate people is what's amazing to me.
Mm.
You know? When you asked me what did I think of it, I hadn't thought about what I thought of it because honestly, that's just Dave.
Yeah.
Chappelle to me.
That's what you expect of him now.
I think I've always expected that. Even when I go to his stand-ups, don't get me wrong, it's funny as fuck, mm-hmm. but it's still more so the messaging. You know what I mean? It's the broader messaging of how straight people and LGBT people can get along.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah.
How black people and white people can get along. You know what I mean? How black people need what we need to do to improve. Like it's always something deeper there. And you laugh, you know, or why we got to rebel against cancel culture. Like it's always messaging. I've never not gone to Dave Chappelle Show and not saw messaging. Even his SNL bit, I thought it was funny as fuck. It wasn't like the 846 thing. 846, there was no punchline.
Right.
This was punchlines. He had jokes. Yeah. You just had to... You know, I guess pay attention to catch him, but I enjoyed it. I enjoyed Dave Chappelle. Dave Chappelle is one of those people that I enjoy watching, listening to.
Yeah.
I just like Dave Chappelle.
Yeah, he's brilliant. I wonder if, like, he's earned our patience. You know, we were talking about this on Flagrant, how, like, Carlin, by the end of his career, like, if you just saw the end of his career, you were like, why is this old man just yelling? But for people who followed him throughout his whole career, they're like, oh, no, he's so funny that he doesn't need to be funny every second. A brand new comic that we haven't heard of, you better be funny,
grace. That grace I was just talking about?
Adios.
You ain't getting none of that.
We're giving you a Hillsong treatment.
Word.
Real talk.
You're fired.
You're out of here, bro.
Now, mind you, I love a good bombing. Okay?
Yes, you do.
I do. Yes, if you hear me laughing at a comedy show, I've already told you, it's because you're bombing or you're really funny. And if you're really, really funny, I'm really not laughing that much because I'm so listening. Like,
you're absorbing
it.
Yeah.
That was brilliant. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And I don't want to. And I know how it is being a comedian when y'all are trying to move on to the next thing. I love comedians that give you that moment. Yeah. That's when you know a motherfucker. That's big dick energy as a comedian, bro.
What's that?
When they lay that joke out and they know they get an audience a second to catch their breath.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? That's the kind I like. Some of y'all do that shit. Y'all throw that shot up thinking y'all gonna give us a moment to catch our breath. And we like, nah,
we're breathing.
We good.
We have enough oxygen.
Fine. We got it. Just wasn't funny.
Yeah, I don't know. That's just the thing for me, at least. Like Dave, I'm just so intrigued by him as a person. And I said this a while back about Dave, and I was like,
I almost think that like just telling jokes is beneath him at this point, because there are certain things that like he probably will want to say without jokes. Mm-hmm. And to feel as if he can't speak unless he's being funny, I'm sure you start to resent that a little bit.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
You know, like if you just want to talk to folks and say interesting things, you should be able to do that.
Yeah.
And I think that, I hope that he's starting to realize that he can do that and we're interested. Maybe not the new generation of kids who don't really know Dave and they're just seeing this version. They might be like, yo, why is this old guy upset? In the same way they felt that way about Carlin.
Yeah.
But all of us that came up with him are like, hey, bro, just talk, man. You gave us tons of funny. We are here to listen.
But that's why it's good Chappelle shows on Netflix now. That's why it's good, you know, his stand-up specials are on Netflix, because we have that material to draw from. You know what I mean? So it's just like everybody always wants the old version of you in the new you. That's done. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? Like, don't expect the old me anymore. I'm not that person. Yeah. But you can go listen to all that old shit. Same thing. Like, motherfuckers can't understand why we think Jay-Z is the best. Yeah. Well, you're not going to get it if you listen to 444. Yeah. You know what I mean? 444 is a culmination of everything from Reasonable Doubt to Blueprint to Hard Knock Life. Like, we've watched this guy go all the way around the world 7 times and bring us back to here. I've been following the journey. Yeah. That's why I'm able to appreciate 444. Because the brother that used to be talking about big pimping and fucking girls and kicking them out after 5 minutes is now the married man who's, you know, raising his children, who's dealing with infidelity himself and trying to figure it out and going to therapy, like trying to be a better him. That's why we appreciate Jay. You're not going to appreciate that if you didn't follow the journey.
Yeah, I wonder that. Like, I wonder if artists that don't have a journey, it doesn't need to be necessarily like evolving as a human being or like changing who you are, but like growing as who you are. I wonder if we have a way deeper connection with those artists.
Yes. When you follow the journey, listen, same thing with Chappelle, right? Chappelle and Chris Rock, it's almost like they're in overtime.
Yeah.
They won already.
You did it, bro.
They're not even on the court with us no more. They're not Mount Rushmore. No, they on Mount Rushmore. When you see them, You're getting a treat for me. Yeah. I can't speak for anybody else. For me, I've seen them become who they are. Same thing with Eddie Murphy.
Yes,
like, I'm not judging Eddie Murphy because of fucking Dolomite, even though Dolomite was great.
Yeah.
Coming to America 2, come out in this whack. That shit don't put a stain on Eddie's legacy to me.
Yeah.
Like, Eddie's still Eddie.
Certified.
I enjoy them, but what I get a thrill out of is watching Andrew Schulz, watching 85 South Show.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Yeah. Watching Little Duval. You know what I mean? Watching Amanda Seals. Even watching Donnell, even though he's a hater. But watching all of these people who are still growing.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? And growing into like just these, like watching Jess Hilarious. When I see her, you know, that skit she put up online yesterday about after a girl cheats and how they question themselves in the car. That shit was funny as fuck. But I love shit like that because I remember that energy.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Yeah. That person that you're looking at and they on the grind, they pushing, they trying to make it, and you see them evolving into their own and becoming these undeniable beasts. That shit gives me a rush.
Motherfuckers,
the other day I said it was during Donkey today, and I said that shit is funny. I said that shit is Dave Chappelle, Andrew Schulz funny. I was using y'all as metaphors, right? And I saw people on YouTube saying, how you put Andrew Schulz and Dave Chappelle in the same sentence? Just wait on it.
Okay.
Just wait on it.
We're
you know
coming.
What I mean?
We're but coming.
That's all I'm saying. Just wait on it. Like, you got to be able to see that. Like, I love the maturation of that. And being that we have a Dave, we have a Chris Rock, we have an Eddie Murphy, we can see the process. So when I look at a you, when I look at an 85 South Show, I'm looking at the trajectory, seeing where y'all can go. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Why is it that some people still expect the same, I guess, level of their art, regardless of how old they get or how long they've been doing it? Like, why is it that some people can't just look at like what we get from Eddie and be like, how lucky that we get even a little bit on SNL or whenever Dave decides to drop something? Why is it we can't look at him and be like, how awesome that we get that? Or Jay drops a verse. Like, maybe we should be looking at that verse like, yeah, okay, it's not an album, but like, how cool is it we get a Jay-Z verse?
People hear Jay verse and be like, Drake better. Like, our Kendrick is better. It's just like, yo, this dude has been doing it for 30 years.
Yeah,
exactly.
Yeah.
Like, when I hear Jay versus, like, I'm like, yo, this dude is, his mind is different. Now, he's a different human. Like, he's unlocked a different level. He's accessed something those young guys, even though they're still dope, haven't accessed yet. And that's the beauty of life. That's why I said all of those guys, man, that's why you got to salute the OGs who are still active, because the OGs that are still active are showing you what the now people are going to become. You know what I mean? Like, that shit is going to be great. It's going to be great. It's great to watch it all. It's great to watch the maturation process of all of these people. But when they get Dave's age, Eddie's age, Chris's age, Hov's age, and they're still putting out art, I'm going to appreciate that too.
Yeah.
Because I saw the journey.
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
We don't respect the journey of people no more, man.
Yo, we don't on the surface, but like in terms of how devout we are as like fans of people, I think we kind of do because those are the people we stick with. You know what I mean? Like Snoop Dogg is still around, bro.
Snoop Dogg is still around.
And I feel like he's just as, maybe, I don't know, just as, but like just as relevant, at least within our generation, as he was
maybe 20 bigger.
Years ago. Maybe even bigger, right?
Maybe bigger.
Yeah, but and it's crazy. His evolution was wild, man. From like gangster rapper, I think he was like producing pornos at one time. Like he had a talk show.
Snoop
like,
had a murder charge.
He had a murder, and then he did a Martha Stewart show.
My daddy made me cut my afro because I had a big ass afro and I used to wear Chuck Taylors. When Snoop had that, that's how big Snoop was. Snoop had a murder charge and he's always been a household name since he's been on the scene.
Yeah.
Every adult always knew who Snoop Doggy Dogg was. Yeah. Even now.
Yeah.
And my daddy was like, you cutting your head because you think you Snoop Doggy Dogg. Snoop on goddamn trial for murder. Like literally, they understood the influence that these people had on us. So to watch Snoop go through all of that and still grow to be him, family man, married, kids, like you said, TV show with Martha Stewart, fucking Corona commercials, all types of shit. Like, Snoop is like, yo, he's on every commercial.
He really is, dude.
I don't even know. I'll be like, I don't even know what the fuck he be advertising. I'm like, oh, that's Snoop again?
Yeah.
And you can't do nothing but love it. You know why? Because he's remained him the whole time.
So maybe the key is you got to change. It's like,
oh, you got to evolve. You got to.
But so that's the thing. It's like, sometimes we get upset at people evolving, right? Because they're maybe changing aspects about themselves that we liked. But the reality is, if you give people the same product for too long, they're going to get tired of that product.
Bro, if you're not evolving, who are you? Like, seriously, you evolve or die.
Yeah.
Like, you can't, like, it's impossible. It's impossible to remain the same. There's a quote, man. Hold on. And I actually saw that. It's so funny. We had Nikki Giovanni on The Breakfast Club. And I posted this quote the day before.
Who is that?
Nikki Giovanni. She's a poet, artist, author, activist. But she's older. She's 77. She said, mistakes are a fact of life. It is the response to error that counts. Mm-hmm. And we don't allow people to make mistakes no more. You understand what I'm saying?
Yeah.
So being that we don't allow people to make mistakes, everybody, especially now, wants to stay the same. They don't want to rock the boat. So if they get into a position, if they get into a position where people expect this from them and that's safe, we like that version of you. Mm. You know, you're not problematic.
Yeah,
you're not doing or saying anything that's offending people.
Yeah.
People don't even realize they become caricatures of that.
Of themselves, yes.
And that don't last. Because it's fake. You gotta make mistakes. Yeah. It's the response to the error that makes you grow. It's the response to the error that makes you evolve.
What do you mean by response to the error? Like,
I made a mistake.
Yeah.
How am I going to respond to that mistake?
How are you going to change? How are you going to atone
how
for
am
it?
I just like, go, yeah, how am I going to respond to that mistake? How am I going to atone for it? How am I going to grow from it? How am I going to evolve from it? That's why we always say, like, there's no such thing as a loss, right? It's just a lesson.
Yeah, yeah.
You know, so I have to respond to that error that I made in a healthy way.
Yeah.
You respond to it in a healthy way, you grow. You respond to it in a healthy way, you evolve. If you tuck your goddamn tail and stay in your bed and put your sheets over your head and don't try to respond to it at all, you just stagnant.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Or if you never try to, if you're not making mistakes, you're just not trying hard enough,
yeah,
bro.
Yeah, if you're never trying to be unique or different or you're exploring yourself, you're not going to make mistakes.
No, I don't. If you think that you're just going to go through this whole thing unscathed, you're never going to say nothing that's going to bother nobody, you're never going to say nothing that's going to offend somebody, you're never going to do something that's going to offend somebody, you're playing it too safe.
Yeah.
And the late, great Jazz Fly used to always say, you can be great or you can be safe, but you can't be both. Yeah. And I truly feel that way. You can be great or you can be safe, but you can't be both.
And you know what's fucked up is we value greatness. We hate people that play it safe, but we don't give people the grace
to make mistakes.
To make the mistakes that will in turn make them great. So we love the finished product, or we love when you are great in the moment, and the second we found out the shit that you had to do to get there, we're like, oh, no, get out of here. That's fucked up. Don't be enjoying a product. You know what it is? It's like enjoying a veal. You know what I mean? Like the food veal.
They'll be banging.
It slaps. And then you find out it's baby cow.
Yeah,
and then
you feel like, a little weight.
Oh, this is horrible.
Yeah,
whatever.
Yeah.
Well, whatever, bro.
That should be slapping, bro. Bill's more tender. You know what I'm saying?
It's more tender.
Is that a good die young?
The good
die. A good meat die young, baby. I'm just saying. Chris is on the other end like, meat eaters. They say meat is destroying the planet, bro.
That's what they're saying, bro. Whatever. We are the meat that's destroying the planet.
Like we are the meat that's destroying the planet. Somebody need to come eat us.
It's not cows. It's us. Like, I hate it when they do that shit. They're like, oh, to fix the planet, we just stop eating cows. Eat us, motherfucker.
That's cows is doing exactly what the fuck they supposed to be doing. Cows grass. Mind their business. They eat their grass. It's us. Mm-hmm. We the meat. That's the problem. But no, this all I'm saying, allow people to make mistakes, because when you allow them to make mistakes, you allow them to grow. You allow them to evolve. Everybody that I just named, that's great. They've all made horrendous mistakes.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? But it helped them grow. Mm-hmm. That's why I'm telling you, my favorite thing to watch is the growth process.
Yeah.
I love it. Like I love watching with 85 South Show. I love watching Just Last. I love watching you. I love the growth. That shit gives me a rush. Like, yo, that's what the fuck I'm talking about. And especially when you know what the end could be.
Yeah.
And by the way, the end for anybody in this era is going to be greater than them.
Right.
Because we saw what they done.
So we have to try to push past that.
They're the bar. Yeah. You're going to do that naturally.
Yeah.
You know why? Because you're competing with those legacies already.
Yeah.
That's just unbelievable. Like, people don't realize how people, we always talk about Michael Jordan.
Yeah.
And his impact on the league. Do you know how many great superstars we got because they tried to be like Mike?
Yeah. Kobe,
just because they strive for that level of greatness.
Yeah.
Just because they weren't afraid to make mistakes.
Yeah, you become the motivation.
Michael Jordan went through that, so you don't have to go through that. Kobe went through that, so you don't have to go through that. Just they became the bar just because they had something to aspire to that was oh, shit.
Yeah, that's true.
That is the beauty of life right there in a nutshell. What else did we see this week that was positive?
I hope people can learn how to appreciate that. I think a lot of people mm-hmm. do, and I think that's why there's a lot of people that get upset by cancel culture and these types
of
things.
It's whack, man.
I know they know it's whack, and I think there's some people who are just like, I want to be able to say whatever I want to say, but I think there's also people who understand the process of becoming like a full human being, and you're going to make mistakes on the way.
That Nikki Giovanni quote, I asked her about that quote. Nikki said, if you're not willing to contradict yourself, you're not growing. And she said, that's why she doesn't go back and read any of her old work.
Because I'm different now.
And she says, if I go back and read my old work, when I write now, I'll try not to contradict myself. It's impossible. You're going to. There's things that I thought 10 years ago, I don't think like that now.
Yeah.
There's things
said the same thing.
Say what? Alex?
Malcolm Gladwell, you said the same thing.
Oh, what? Yeah, when he was here on Britain Innes, he did. Malcolm said, and remember, I got upset because I was like, bro, your shit is like a Bible to me.
You know what I mean?
And, yo, that's a good point that you just said that, Alex, because I thought about that, you know, even writing my books, right? In the future,
you're going to feel differently than the shit you put down on paper.
But guess what? There's somebody out there growing the same way that I was growing. So that information I gave them in a black privilege,
get them to a place.
Exactly. Yeah, I gave them some steps for where I was at in my life at that moment.
Yeah,
when you're ready for the next step, then you go grab Shook One.
Yeah.
This is me going through therapy. And then the next book will be another version of that.
Transformation.
You know what I mean? Exactly. Yeah. So it's just like same thing with Malcolm Gladwell. Malcolm Gladwell was like, the 10,000 hours, that's where I was at then. You know what I mean? I might still apply some of it to my life now, but for the most part, no.
Yeah.
But for somebody else on the come up, that moment in time, they need that right now.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like some people are farther along in their evolution and growth than other people.
Yeah.
And
you need the inspiration for each step.
You need the inspiration for each fucking step. So that's what Nikki Giovanni said. She's like, yo, if you're not willing to contradict yourself, then you're not growing.
Yeah.
And that's real.
That's fire.
That's real. You got to be willing to be a contradiction. The motherfuckers act like that's a bad thing. You're contradicting yourself. Like, so what?
Yeah.
I changed my mind. What the fuck? So what? I got more information.
Yeah.
I learned a little bit more. I got some new experiences. Yeah. So the fuck what?
I was insecure. How much of the shit we did was just because we're insecure?
All of it.
Literally. All of it, bro. Yeah.
God damn it.
I didn't like myself enough.
Yes.
Imagine you just start saying that. Imagine you keep realizing, like, yeah, why would you say that? No, I just didn't like myself enough.
You do say that when you go to therapy. I say that all the time.
I mean, like, publicly, that was the answer. Like, how could you tweet such a thing? I was feeling insecure and I was lashing out at other people because I wasn't happy.
Man.
Like, what are you going to say? What are you going to say to me if I say that? Like, I didn't mean it. It had all to do with myself.
I was in therapy.
Sorry, it hurt people.
Last Friday, I was in therapy. Mm-hmm. And I was talking about a couple things that happened over the past couple of weeks. And I connected it to when I was young, growing up in Monk's Corner, wanting to be accepted by people. Mm. You know what I'm saying? So I would do whatever I needed to do to be accepted by
whatever group was in
this crowd, right? Yeah, yeah. So if you know you're in the street, you're doing street shit. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? And your thought process, mine was always like, I know I would have these people back if something went down, but would they have mine?
Uh-huh.
You know what I mean? Like if a fight broke out, guns, shoot, whatever. I know what I would do just to prove that I'm down with them, but would they have my back? And, you know, full circle as an adult, you know, there was a couple situations that happened and I was like, how do I know that person really down for me in this way? You know what I mean? Yeah. And it really did make me feel like I felt when I was a kid just seeking approval.
Yeah.
You know what I'm saying? Like wanting to know, like really beating myself up. Like, I know I would do anything to be approved by these folks, but I don't know if they would have my back. So in the future, like now, it's like I didn't put myself out there for these people. Where they at right now?
Yeah.
You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And my therapist was just like, they're very busy. She was like, because I was explaining the whole situation, and she was like,
people have lives.
They're busy. Yeah, and, yeah. And she was like, but you're also telling me that this person does say X, Y, and Z to you. And this person does reach out for this. And this person does reach out for that. And I'm like, I'm sitting there thinking to myself, like, holy shit, she's right. Yeah. Like, I just wanted to show up the way I wanted to show up.
But it's
showing up. Like, the person is giving me the validation that I need and letting me know they're down for me.
Yeah.
But I wanted a certain way.
Yeah.
So being that I wanted a certain way, I can't even see how I'm actually receiving it.
Yeah, yeah.
And I'm like, holy fucking shit. But it's just amazing how all of that shit can bring you back to what you just said, that insecurity, that, you know, not feeling like you're enough and wanting validation from, you know, other people. Because
when you're feeling insecure, like, you can see the world through that. Like, if you're not feeling you're enough, every interaction you have is seeking to justify that.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Like, you talking to somebody and then they look bored when you're talking to them, and then you're like, ah, that's probably because I'm porn. You know what I'm saying? Not because that motherfucker didn't sleep at all the day before.
Or because he's looking for a text from his wife or his kids.
Yeah, it's like, you don't know what they're doing. But you look at, if you're feeling insecure, you can only justify that one feeling you have.
And on the same level,
it's like, if you're feeling really good about yourself, you're only justifying that too. Like, if you're feeling really good about yourself and somebody looks at your phone, you might find some crazy justification about how dope you are. They're like, yeah, they were probably writing that shit down.
Yeah, we don't deal with our insecurities enough, man.
Yeah, we're not supposed to.
Nah, we definitely
supposed to. No, we are, but like culturally, we're not supposed to. Like, we're not even supposed to be insecure.
As a man, insecurity. Yeah. Yeah, let me tell my dad I was insecure back in the day and watch how fast he called me a maggot. All right? Okay? And replace that M with an F. I'm serious. Like, immediately.
Insecure.
Why, if you don't get outside and go there and play some football or something? Like, seriously, like, insecure. What the fuck is insecure? That is the worst part about being a man, bro. We're not supposed to express our vulnerabilities, man. That shit is fucked up. Yeah. And that is why we created a generation of motherfuckers that was toxic as shit.
But that's why we're funny, though, too.
Yeah,
though.
That's funny. That's the other thing that nobody wants to admit.
It's true. Because women are okay expressing their insecurities, and then they don't develop roasts. Do you know what I'm saying? We're dudes, we can't, so we just gotta roast the shit out of our friends.
The shit out of you.
I feel horrible, so I gotta make you feel bad.
That's
like me.
All it was, everybody I used to tease in school, I was shooting first.
I went through that
sixth and seventh grade year getting bullied. All of y'all getting, I don't give a fuck.
It's over.
I don't know who in this room got it. So everybody getting sprayed. All right? I don't give a fuck. And that's how I used to be. So you come off as a bully,
right,
but you're really just defending yourself because you've been bullied.
Yes,
I used to wear glasses and had a fanny pack and used to get body slammed every fucking day. When them glasses hit the ground that day and shattered, I said it's on. I had a fucking enough. All right.
You used to wear glasses?
Did I used to wear glasses? Hell yeah, I used to wear glasses. I might post that picture one day. It's out there. It's a glass. I got the glasses, and the glasses are crooked. Because I used to get fucking beat up every day and bullied by my cousins. And this shit's crooked with one fucking lens. Literally, it's a sixth grade picture. Shit is like that. I look at that little boy. I see that hurt in that little boy's eyes.
Why did you fix him, though?
You become the worst motherfucker you possibly can.
Wait, hold on. Why? All right.
It's a supervillain story, yes. Bro. Yes. He's a supervillain. He's really a supervillain.
But that's how you got to be, though. You got to turn into the baddest motherfucker.
So no one fucks with you. Yeah.
And I'm not even talking about on some violent shit. Nah. Just that motherfucker is crazy.
Yeah. Don't fuck with him.
Why didn't you just, you know, change your glasses for the picture, though?
Well, excuse me, Miss Laura Marion House, who grew up, you know, where the house itself for $800,000. Yeah. Okay. All right. We didn't have no money, Taylor.
No, but you said they were crooked. You could, like, your ears aren't crooked. Why don't you just...
She right, though. She right. If the glasses were like this, just rotate that bitch down. No, right.
The glasses were fucked up. The glasses were big.
But her logic is mad funny. Your ears ain't crooked. You just put the glass on, right?
Hold on, I got a piss. Let's pay some bills. All right. Sorry to stop so abruptly, but that's how it goes sometimes. All right, let's talk about Quip. When's the last time you got rewarded for brushing your teeth? Sadly, that is the era that we live in where people have to get rewarded for brushing their teeth. Well, Quip's new smart electric toothbrush proved that good habits can earn you great perks like free products, gift cards, and more. The Quip Smart Brush for adults and kids connects to the Quip app with Bluetooth. All right, track when and how well you brush, get tips and coaching to improve your habits. This is actually a great idea because my daughter has braces and me and my wife have to really be on her about brushing and flossing and stuff like that. So earn points for daily brushing and bonus points for completing challenges, okay? Redeem for rewards. You already have a Quip? Upgrade it with a smart motor and keep the features you know and love. Sensitive sonic vibrations, 2-minute timer with 30-second pulses for a guided clean. Slim, lightweight, and sleek with no wires or bulky charger to weigh you down. Multi-use travel cover that doubles as a mirror mount for less clutter. Beyond the brush, Quip has everything you need to build a complete routine. Floss that expands to clean and comes in a refillable dispenser to reduce waste. An eco-friendly solar battery charger to power your Quip with sunshine. And a refresh bag to bring your good oral care habits everywhere you go. Plus, you can get brush head? What? What? Gee, I need a Quip now. Toothpaste and floss refills delivered from $5 and shipping is free. How smart is that? Join over 5 million mouse who use Quip and save hundreds compared to other Bluetooth brushes when you get a Quip smart brush for just $45. Start getting rewards for brushing your teeth today and go to getquip.com/idiots right now to get your first refill free. That's your first refill free at getquip.com/idiots, spelled getquip.com/idiots. Quip, better oral health made simple and rewarding. And today's show is also brought to you by HelloFresh. You can get fresh pre-measured ingredients and mouth-watering seasonal recipes delivered right to your door with HelloFresh, America's number one meal kit. HelloFresh lets you skip those trips to the grocery store and makes home cooking easy, fun, and affordable. The recipes are easy to follow with simple steps and pictures to guide you along the way. HelloFresh cuts out stressful meal planning and grocery store trips so you can enjoy cooking and get dinner on the table in about 30 minutes. HelloFresh delivers fresh, high-quality, pre-portioned ingredients so you can make meals that are delicious and nutritious. Over 90% of ingredients are sourced directly from growers to ensure peak flavors and ripeness. There's something everyone will enjoy, including 20-minute meals, low-calorie, vegetarian, family-friendly recipes, and more. HelloFresh delivers pre-portioned ingredients so you're not overbuying, which is a burden on the planet and your wallet. Okay, now, go to HelloFresh.com/idiots90 and use code idiots90 to get $90 off, including free shipping. That's code idiots90 at HelloFresh.com/idiots90 to get $90 off your order, including free shipping. Now, let's get back to the show. Let's do some church announcements. I don't have any church announcements, just simply the Black Effect Podcast Network. That's it. Black Effect Podcast Network. What did we put out this week? Ebony K. Williams is out now, holding court, new episode. She's talking about the MVP, Madam Vice President, Kamala Harris. Teslin Figaro, Straight Shot, No Chaser is out.
MVPs.
Gangsta Chronicles is out. New episode of All the Smoke is out. What else is out, Taylor? Oh, damn. I'm bugging.
Yeah, the Jeezy thing.
Yeah, Jeezy. That's something that we're going to be doing at the Black Effect Podcast Network. We're going to be doing specialty podcasts, limited edition podcasts for when people have projects coming out. So Jeezy's Recession 2 album is coming out. So he's doing a podcast every week, you know, and every podcast episode is in conjunction with a theme from a song off his album. So by the time his six episodes, I think it's 6 to 8 episodes, by the time the episodes are done, you know, you'll know exactly why he did a podcast with Tony Robbins or whoever else he has coming up. The first episode is a conversation between Jeezy and Tony Robbins.
Get out of here.
Oh, yeah, because Jeezy loves Tony Robbins. That's loves sick. Tony Robbins. Like, literally, when me and Jeezy sat down, you know, a while ago, he was like, man, I need to get Tony Robbins. And it just so happened I had literally just did something with Tony Robbins. I had just did something with Tony like the week before. So I had that relationship.
Can you speak about that at all or what?
What do you mean?
The thing you did with Tony. I'm fascinated by him.
It was out. It came out. It was a panel. I don't know where it aired, but it was me, the Reverend Jesse Jackson, Tony Robbins. I mean, it was something that we did like a while ago. It was over the summer that we did it. Because I remember it was in June because it was like, matter of fact, it was the day Jazz died. Or the day I got the news that she died.
And what was your reaction to him? Like, what'd you think about
Tony?
Him? Yeah, legit.
I mean, he seemed like, you know what he's talking about to me.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, I've always known a Tony Robbins and, you know, I've
can you break down like what he is or like who pastor, does to people? No, not really. It's not religious.
He's not?
He's like a motivational speaker, but like motivates people like with their lives. He helps them with incredible, like tragic things going on, you know?
And he's a giver. He's a hell of a philanthropist. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. So I
think he's genuinely saved probably thousands of lives. Like people on the verge of suicide. I think he's saved thousands of lives.
I mean, I the reason I probably say he's legit is because people always have negative things to say about him.
Yeah.
So. I'm serious. I mean, I don't trust people that don't have a strong group of people that negatively have something to say about them.
Yeah.
That's my type of person. I like polarizing people. Yeah. I like people that people love hard.
Or hate.
And then I like people that, I like the opposite, people that hate them just as hard. Because that lets me know that person's somewhere in the middle.
Yeah.
So therefore, that means he's being real.
Yeah.
That means he's authentic.
Yeah.
Whatever it is, he's been authentic at it.
Yeah.
You know? So salute to him.
What?
Trump.
What do you mean?
And say that same definition with him.
He's authentic.
You think he's authentic?
Trump?
Oh, I thought he just cares about himself.
That's authentic?
No, but I mean, he'll... snake oil salesman. Like, he'll just sell you whatever. Just
nah, he's authentic. He's too consistent not to be authentic.
I think he's phony, though, too. Like, I think there's some phony in him.
I think it's some showman in him.
Yeah, but like...
Performative can come off as phony.
Yes. Like, I think, like... He'll say what needs to be said to get what he wants, put it that way.
By the way, I've never said I dislike Trump. I just said I don't want him to be president because I understand he's dangerous. I find that motherfucker extremely entertaining.
Oh.
And we've said on this podcast a million times, if he wasn't president, he'd be the funniest person alive.
Can't wait for the news network. I can't wait for the Trump
news network. Oh, you know the Trump news network is coming.
That's why Fox is shaking in their boots.
Yes, so long story short, go check the Jeezy Recession podcast on Black Effect iHeartRadio. It's available wherever you get podcasts now. Now, shit we won't care about next week. You're absolutely right, Schulz. Trump news network is coming. And it was coming before he was president.
That was the point, apparently.
That was the plan. Yeah. They said he was just trying to... He didn't think he was going to win. He was just trying to get big enough in that space
to start a
media the way he company. Can launch a news network.
Yeah.
That's what the whole fake news... Now that he told y'all about fake news. Now I'm going to give y'all the real shit. His version of the real shit.
Yeah.
Listen, I watch Fox now.
Of course.
You think I'm not going to watch the Trump news network?
Yo,
I need to hear that bullshit.
You need to watch both.
I need that bullshit in my life.
But that's the thing, like, you need to watch both to get a decent idea of what the fuck is going on. Because the left is going to tell you the left side, right is going to tell you the right side.
That's
the only
right.
way to be in the middle is to listen and
that's
watch
right.
both of them.
That's right.
But yeah, he's getting, what I'm thinking is he's fucking over Fox big time because a lot of those cats on Fox are going to run right over to Trump immediately.
If he got the money to pay him.
Why wouldn't he?
I mean, it's going to cost to get a Sean Hannity. I mean, for a startup, unless he gives Sean equity in the company, you
maybe.
Know what I mean? Something to that nature.
Maybe.
Sean Hannity makes a lot of money at Fox, bro.
You don't think that there'll be like people lining up to support this venture? Trump's not going to put up his own money.
If I was Trump, I'd go grab Bill O'Reilly. You know what I'm saying? Bill ain't been on TV in a minute. I'll go grab Tommy Lauren. Tommy's not full time on Fox.
You need Tucker.
I'll go get Candace Owens.
You got to get Tucker.
You think so?
Yeah, because Tucker runs that shit, bro.
You put, but Bill can be, Tucker is in Bill's old time slot
so
now.
So if Bill gets busy again?
Yeah, you put Bill on 8 o'clock.
Yeah, interesting.
Put Bill on. I thought, go get Alex Jones.
Yeah, that's a wild boy.
Like, I'm just saying, there's a lot of different conservative voices you can go get. What's the other dude name? Well, he might not leave Fox, but he's not like a, is he a full contributor on Fox? What's the dude name? Hold on.
Who?
I'm going to tell you right now. I see his, I've never listened to his podcast. I've seen him on CNN every now and then.
What does he look like?
Oh, I'm going to tell you what his name is right now. His name is Dan Bongino.
I don't know.
Oh, Dan. I mean, I don't know him, but I just see his podcast is always number one.
Really?
Always. Always.
I've never heard
even
of
over Rogan. Dan Bongino. Really? Yeah. Dan Bongino. I don't know him personally. I've seen him on Fox a couple of times, but yeah, go I'm grab some of them. Up. All I'm saying is the Trump News Network gonna hit.
It's going to hit.
I was sitting there, I was saying Trump gonna go to jail, but what you said last week make a lot of sense. Like, yo.
Bro, that's a weird looking human being, though. He looks like a Lego. That's a weird looking human being, bro. Look at this guy. Yo. That's crazy, dude. Oh, yo. My God. It needs to fit into the hat.
You know the main reason nobody should be celebrating if you're a Democrat?
Why?
Because it took acts of God in order for Joe Biden to win the presidency.
Yeah.
There's no COVID.
Yeah, he not
Donald losing. Trump's reelected.
He not losing.
There's no COVID. Donald Trump is reelected.
You needed something that was this catastrophic to showcase Trump's ineptitude. It's like we act like being president is the hardest thing. Bruh, you said this to me once when you were talking about The Daily Show. I think like it was like if Trevor was going to be able to do okay when he came in. Mm-hmm. And you were like, The Daily Show is a, how'd you say it?
It's a system.
It's a system. Like, yeah. You could put somebody else in the system, but that thing has a lot of moving parts, and those moving parts are going to continue to move regardless Absolutely. Who's at the helm. And I think that's the same with America. Like, I really think any idiot could run America because there's so many other people that have responsibilities.
Nah, not any idiot.
Let me make the full point.
Yeah.
I think when times are good, the economy's humming and all that kind of stuff, I think any idiot could do it, more or less. Maybe not an idiot, but like, I don't think...
Anybody with common sense.
Yeah, you could...
You don't have to be a genius, scholar.
Exactly.
Academic. Yeah.
Exactly,
yeah.
Right? But a pandemic really exposes your leadership. You got to be able to lead through a pandemic. And his leadership was never for the whole country.
Because he's not willing to listen. Because that's the other thing about a president, and the same thing about when you put him in the system. George Bush can sit there and read the book upside down because he knows he's about to be told what to do by 100 different people. And all the fuck he got to do is listen and deliver the speech that the writers write for him.
Yeah.
Trump can't do it.
Yeah, that's true.
He's incapable of following a system. He's incapable of listening to anybody except for that person that's inside his head.
Because he's never worked within systems. He's always worked outside of them. You know what I mean? Like, even when it comes to like the development deals or even his own show or all these things, he's always been the boss.
He's literally
people, you know, have always said that thing about like, what if he ran a country like a business? It's like, well, that's what he's doing. And it doesn't work like that. That's not what countries are.
They're not a business.
When you're a steak restaurant, you only got to appease the motherfuckers that eat steak.
Yeah.
When you run a country, you got to appease the motherfuckers that eat vegan shit, that eat shrimp, that don't eat nothing at all. You got to appease everybody.
That is the other thing that they showed us, right? Like Democrats, we always say Democrats have too wide a tent. They're trying to please too many people.
Mm-hmm.
There's something in the middle, right? You can't be like Trump and just cater to one base, and you can't please everybody, because if you try to please everybody, you're going to end up pleasing nobody. But there's got to be some type of middle ground that people can find. And I think it comes down to just taking the basic essentials that humans need.
Yeah.
All humans, first of all, we just want to feel safe.
Yeah.
Right? Equality, that's the shit that America promises us, right? Can we get some of that, right?
Yep.
That's number one.
Yep.
Financially stable, right?
Yeah.
Education, healthcare. Those are the basics.
Yeah.
And by the way, some people don't want the education.
Yeah.
But education to me don't just mean school. It means like, job training. Like,
sure.
Send people to carpentry class.
Trades.
Yeah. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like, people just want to be able to know how to do something, know how to make money from it, and feel safe.
Survive, man. Feel safe. Yeah,
100%. That's all we want in America.
Low key, that's what the majority of people voted for.
Yes.
Like, they voted for safety and security.
Yes.
They were tired of, like, the culture war. They were tired of, like, the exhausting daily nonsense that went along mm-hmm. with, and it's not just Trump, but how the media follows Trump and how everything is inflated. People are tired of that. Mm-hmm. They're like, it's too much. I don't want this.
I don't know though. Cause listen, Schulz, we say people were tired of it. Everybody's like, oh, Joe Biden broke. Joe Biden had the most votes ever in the president.
Yeah.
So Trump had two.
But here's the thing.
Trump was number two.
I said the majority of people are tired of it. I didn't say all.
Yeah.
And I think the majority of people, because the tricky thing also for Democrats, and I feel almost bad because I was shitting all over Democrats for the last year for the candidates they ran. But given the fact that the pandemic happened, they actually ran a perfect candidate. They got lucky with that. But like the tricky thing for Democrats is like, how do you appeal to minorities and like rural whites or whatever the fuck they call those white people? Basically poor whites.
By giving them essentials.
But yet here's the thing. What's interesting is that like usually by appealing to minorities, those whites allegedly get annoyed because they're like, oh, they're going to take our jobs or they're going to take our opportunity. They're going to take things away from us. So that's why they tend to skew conservative because conservatives will play into them and not into the minorities mm-hmm. as much, right? So, but what happened with Biden was really interesting is Biden was able to appeal to those rural whites because that's kind of like what he is. I'm from Scranton and all that kind of stuff. But at the same time, outside of the crime bill, you couldn't really call him racist because who was he in the office with for 8 years?
Yeah, that wasn't enough for me though.
Wasn't it for you? Yeah. But for the average voter, it was way more than some other white stiff. Like if you just had some other white stiff there, you could paint him as complete racist way easier than you could paint Biden, because if he's such a racist, why would Obama have him there for 8 years?
I think you made great points, but COVID, bro.
No, you're right.
I don't think none of that works without COVID.
Yo, but you're right. But how ironic is it, or maybe it's not even ironic, that like Obama picked Biden specifically because he's like, this will make the white people comfortable.
He picked the most conservative Democrat he could find.
Right? He's like, this is how I'm going to get the whites comfortable with me.
I went and got the guy that locked up tens of thousands of black men.
Exactly.
You know, Tough on Crime Joe.
Those
crime bills he wrote with Strom Thurmond. You remember all that, right? That's him.
Well, the other side of the seesaw just happened.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? I don't know. It's an interesting election time.
I know that Corona. The Democrats catching hell in 2024, though.
You really believe so?
In future elections, yeah. You know why? Because centrist Democrats and progressives need to sit down and have a conversation.
Yeah.
Because Joe Biden represents something that's, he's a relic of the past. You know what I mean? That will do for now, but he's a placeholder.
What if that's what people want? What if the majority of people do want a centrist and they don't want the extremes on either side, the extreme Trump or the extreme AOC?
They say that, but then when you talk about progressive policies, everybody wants progressive policies. They want free healthcare.
That's a great point.
You know what I mean? They want free education.
Yeah.
They want universal basic income. Like all of the stuff they give Andrew Yang and Bernie Sanders and AOC for. The problem with the progressives, and it's not even a problem.
They don't know how to market it.
Just like the Democrats don't know how to message. It's bad messaging. Just get rid of the wording. If you are a centrist Democrat or even a conservative, and I say, yo, you want free healthcare? Yo, you want free education? Yo, you want universal basic income? All right, you're a socialist.
And I'm just like, yo, stop using the word
Democrat. Using the word socialist.
Don't use the word socialist. Don't use democratic. Stop calling each other comrade. You know what I mean? It. Like, get out of
That's
here with
it.
That shit.
Yeah, that's
just
it.
Lean into American patriotism. You're an American patriot and you want to provide for the people, and then that's it.
You want everything America says they offering.
Mm-hmm.
Freedom, justice, liberty for all, equality, whatever. That's it. You're right. I wanted just the land of milk and honey, right? Where the fuck is the milk and the honey? Yeah, that's all I want.
Also, who drinks that?
Whoa. You've never had a milk and honey pedicure?
No.
Woo! You ain't living right. What?
But I'm sure that expression existed before milk and honey pedicures. Like somebody was probably drinking milk and honey, some fucking psychopath.
I've never tried it, but that milk and honey pedicure, my God.
But like, have you drank it?
No. They just do it for your feet.
But that's not where the expression comes from. The expression comes from some fucking weirdo drinking milk with honey in it.
The first time I ever got one, I got it because of America's branding of milk and honey.
Somebody branded milk and honey. Yes. Like it's the best thing, right? It's like chocolate chips and cookies
now,
go together.
Now, Honey Nut Cheerios used to taste good now.
Now, you're onto something.
Honey Nut Cheerios.
You're onto something.
With the goddamn milk. That shit used to taste good back in the day.
You're onto something. You're not. Yeah, you're onto
something.
Maybe
it is something. Maybe honey and milk is a good combination.
Maybe it is. I would just never put honey in milk. It would be so odd.
I don't like milk. I'm lactose intolerant. But I might try that milk and some almond milk and some honey.
We'll give it a go, I guess.
Listen, the moral of the story is get you a milk and honey pedicure. That shit is amazing, bro. That shit, and they poured it like cream on your leg with the honey.
Yeah,
and it's sticky.
Yeah.
It's almost like you can see why people like getting nutted on a little bit. What? That's not it? What? No, you can see.
People, it keeps happening. You definitely not in
you see pornos.
Yeah, or my dreams. You know what I mean?
Okay, Taylor. Where do you let your guy shoot it?
Who said that we're going raw?
Oh, okay. You aren't.
But you don't have to go raw though. The guy can take the condom off.
That's true.
Yeah, y'all can be having sex. He about to nutty. Take the condom off.
Yeah, doesn't mean I enjoy it.
Oh, I didn't know.
I thought girls like it.
I did too.
I'm glad that he came, but after, like, it's like that one bit of sensation, like, oh, and then right after, it's like, all right, get this shit off.
Yeah, that's how we feel too. That's how everybody feels after sex. You're a communist,
yo. Why?
Because you don't want to provide nobody that milk and honey.
Yes, that's true also. I'm just going with it. I'm trying to build some steam.
See what we can build here.
Build a little momentum. Just
throwing some stuff out, you know what I mean? Let's see if we can build on this. How can we equate ejaculation to socialism, communism, America's freedom, liberty, justice for all, the land of milk and honey, you know what I mean?
Oh, I got it.
Yeah, because
these conservatives just want to jerk themselves off.
Ooh.
But a socialist would jerk off the people around them as well.
A circle jerk. Instead of saying socialism, my God, progressives should just be like, we want to do a circle jerk of America.
That's it.
Yo, that's the, I'm telling you, it's all about messaging. If progressives say we want to do circle jerks of all Americans as opposed to socialism, let's all get in a circle. Yes. Let's all jerk each other off. Yes. Is there anything that will bring people together more?
No.
Woo! Well,
Trump brings it together when he does his little dance.
That's he's already started the circle jerk. He has the dance for it. Macho man.
Maybe he was trying to bring people together in that moment.
I want to be a macho man. Because
that's what you want from your leader, right?
To be jerking off
people? You want a leader that's going to jerk you off.
Facts, though.
You do.
That's true,
you're
man.
A liar. You would love for your boss to jerk you off. I'm not talking about literally. I'm just talking about like in life, you would want him to treat you like I would jerk your dick off.
Al?
What do y'all think y'all call when they say
schmooze a person?
Yeah, that's what that is.
Is it though?
Schmooze. That's a schmooze. Listen, all I know is circle jerk across America should be a campaign slogan for progressives. Straight up.
Smooth.
We're gonna all, cause think about it, that's what you're doing, right? We're all jerking each other off. Yeah. I'm taking a little, I'm letting you take more of my tax money.
Yeah.
Cause I know it's helping the next man.
Yeah.
We're all jerking each other off, bro.
Schmooze.
Let's call it schmusion. Maybe circle jerk might be too much for cable news. Let's call it schmusing. But it's just a different, it's just gotta be about language, right? Messaging matters.
I agree with you on that.
Yes, messaging matters. That's all I'm saying. Socialism gotta go. Defund the police gotta go. Packing the court gotta go. Reparations, because all of these things can happen.
They're antagonistic.
They just gotta have different names.
Yeah.
Reparations should be economic equity packages or universal basic income.
Yeah.
Call socialism compassionate capitalism. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
Packing the court should be expanding the court because the court's already packed.
Yeah.
With conservatives.
Equalizing the court.
Equalize the court. Defunding the police should be, no, we just want to take, you know, the police budgets are bloated. Restructuring the police. I'm going to take some of this money and put it over into the community. That makes y'all jobs safer because we provide more opportunity to these so-called criminals. You know what I mean? Maybe they won't be out here robbing and killing each other and selling dope if we just invest a little bit more milk and honey into the hood. That's all.
Yeah, yeah.
That's it. Just change the language.
I've always felt that way with white privilege. That it assumes that not being killed by the cops is a privilege, and that shouldn't be a privilege. That should be a bare minimum.
Mm, yeah.
And I feel like there'd be way more support for that, especially amongst, like, you know, whites, if the issue was like, hey, black people aren't getting a basic human right. Why don't we help lift them up to basic human rights instead of, hey, look how lucky you are. White people, you don't. Mm-hmm. You're so lucky you don't get killed by the cops. It's like, no, nobody should get killed by the fucking cops.
Yeah, I'm not.
Does
white.
That make sense?
Yeah, I'm not white, so I can't speak to it. But I would also think that if you're a poor white kid growing up in a rural area, you'll take the chance of getting killed by police if you can get some fucking money for your skin color. You know what I'm saying? Like, because white privilege assumes that all white people are rich and nobody's poor and everybody's doing well.
Yeah.
If you're a white person that's poor and the only thing you get as a consolation prize is, oh, I don't get killed by the police?
Like, yeah, whoop-de-doo.
Yeah. You know what I'm saying? No, I want some of that. I want that real. I want them riches. Because I think that's what people really equate it to, right? They're like, no, white privilege means that everybody's doing great. That's white.
Right.
It's not the case.
Right.
You know what I mean? Like, I grew up in Monks Corner, South Carolina. Thomas was my neighbor. That's my first white friend. Thomas was just as poor as us.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So
somebody's going to figure out how to do that. Like, somebody's going to figure out the messaging that shows that, like, poor whites and poor minorities have a more similar life.
Yeah, it's called poverty.
Yeah, poverty.
That should be its own race.
But somebody's going to find the way to, like, connect those groups, because usually those groups are at opposition, but somebody's going to find a way to, like, connect those groups. And the politician that can connect those groups is going to change this country, man.
Well,
circle jerk.
Set up the goddamn circle jerk.
Circle jerk.
You know what I'm saying?
But that experience is so similar.
If you're making less than $20,000 a year and you got three or four people in your household, pull up.
Pull out.
Pull up, pull out. Pull up, pull out. We about to have a nice circle jerk. Okay, and you know what comes with that circle jerk?
What's that?
Free education if you want one. Free job training if you want it. Universal basic income. Free healthcare. Let's go. Good. What else do you want?
Sounds good.
That's it.
Can't hate on it.
You can't hate on it. Taylor, what else we got for things that we won't care about next week?
I wanted to mention with Trump, too, they booked the wrong Four Seasons.
Oh, they're doing the Million MAGA March this weekend, too.
Yeah.
With her? No, where?
I think it's in D.C.
Yeah, in D.C.
Million MAGA March. Alex Jones said the Calvary is coming.
No.
Bro, they're doing the Million MAGA March.
No, they're not.
Oh, act like you ain't get the newsletter.
I swear to God. I swear to God.
They're doing the Million MAGA March this weekend. I think it's in, I'm pretty sure it's in D.C.
It's in D.C.
Yeah, Million MAGA March in D.C., baby.
No
They protesting at the White House because their guy lost. By the way, I hate this too. You know why? Because 2016, Republicans were definitely clowning Democrats for losing the election.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, y'all said it was rigged. Y'all say Russians helped us, yada, yada, yada. And now, 4 years later, it's the exact same thing, just coming from the right.
They're both hypocrites.
And Trump could land a $100 million book deal.
Oh, yeah, he could get
what?
That. $100 million book deal.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you make crazy money after you become president.
Listen,
I think the Clintons made like $100 million after they were in the office.
Nah, Trump will be the most. I think Barack has gotten the most so far.
What did he make after?
I think him and Michelle got 65. Yeah, 65 for their two books. Barack's book actually comes out next week. What else we got, Taylor? Oh, Ron DeSantis, too. You're a fucking idiot.
What'd he do?
He's got this law that he's passing to where you can shoot looters.
Expand or something like that.
You can shoot looters, and if he defines looting as if you're 500 feet away from a building that's got damage or some shit like that. Like, that's broad as fuck. And he's seeking immunity for people that run over protesters. So if you're blocking traffic, you can run over somebody in a car and it can be, you can kill them and it's considered an accident. He's granting immunity to them if they're blocking traffic.
Florida is a wild
ass
place.
A wild fucking place. He's basically saying open season on protesters.
Wow.
That's literally all he's saying. You might as well just say we're fucking protesters up. like that's it.
Interesting.
That shit is whack, because how can you implement all of these laws and legislation for the people fighting against injustice, but not just implement laws and legislation to keep the injustice from happening? Yeah. Like, it's really just that simple.
Yeah.
Instead of putting all that energy into the people that are actually fighting the good fight, put that energy into making sure these things don't
happen. Never happen in the first place.
The fuck? What else, Taylor? What we got?
I don't know if y'all care anymore about Dr. Dre's ex-wife. Thinks he's...
I care about this. Nah.
Okay.
Don't give a fuck.
Keke Palmer criticized over EBT. Healthy food comment.
We spoke about that on Breakfast Club. My only thing with that is, like, it's not that people might not want to eat healthy. It's just that you got to stretch your money on EBT. And healthy food costs fucking money.
Yeah.
So when you're going to the store to use your EBT, you're buying cheap shit because you want to stretch your motherfucking EBT. You might only have $200 on the EBT. You can't eat healthy.
What'd you think about T.I. walking back those comments?
Oh, yeah.
He was capping a little bit, huh?
No, I didn't think he was capping. I thought that we kind of spoke on this earlier. I think that when you're hurt, you're not hearing anything. all those young brothers are hurt. All those young sisters are hurt. So that's, they didn't want to hear that. You know what I'm saying?
But he said he wasn't even referring to that. So King Von got shot and killed. Rapper named King Von got shot and killed in Atlanta. And then T.I. said on his story, like, stop moving to Atlanta and bring your beef here and shooting each other.
Yeah.
It was clear.
He didn't have nothing to do with them. I don't know what you're talking about.
Just said it.
I mean, listen, like, I can only go by T.I.'s word, but yes, I can see why it sounds like it was cap. Yeah. You know what I mean? But, I understand what T.I.'s point was, but what T.I. should have said, and I can't tell a brother what he should have said, but I would have said, yo, brothers, just stop killing each other.
Yeah.
Because it's confusing, right? Because rappers also say, on sight. It's on sight. I don't care if I catch him in church.
Yeah.
It's going down. You know what I mean? So it's just like, that was an on sight moment. They didn't give a fuck what state they was in, what city they was in. He had an issue. He handled it. Things went bad. I hate to see it, but I understood where T.I. was coming from. It's just that, yo, timing is everything, because you want your message to be received, right?
Yeah.
And people aren't hearing you when you're hurt, when they're hurt. You know what I'm saying? That's what I say. Healed people hear differently. Hurt people hear differently too.
Yeah.
You know, T.I. said what he said. Basically, yo, brothers, y'all need to stop beefing. Don't bring that stuff. Because any OG will tell you that. You come to my city, don't make my city hot.
What was wrong about what he said? That part I didn't understand. Like, I completely agree with what he said.
No, I think it was the part of, Don't kill people. Don't kill each other here. Kill yourself in your own city.
Oh, is that what?
I mean, that's how I took it. That's what I read. He said, handle your beast in your city. You know, don't come to Atlanta with that. Which any OG will say, don't come over here making our block hot. But the message got to be, especially coming from somebody like T.I., the message got to be, you know, don't beef, period. Because people will be so quick to call you a hypocrite. But I go back to what we talked about earlier. If you're not contradicting yourself, you're not growing.
Yeah.
Yes, T.I. is the same guy who went to Houston and fought Little Flip. T.I. is the same guy who was in Las Vegas and ran up on Floyd Mayweather.
Who won between Little Flip?
I don't know who won.
Remember that song by Little Flip? Little Flip. Flip.
Game flip. Over?
Flip.
Yeah.
Game over.
T.I. was the same guy who ran down that on fire, who ran down bro. On Mayweather in Vegas.
T.I.
the same guy who went to the Bowen Holmes Projects, rest in peace Shorty Low, and did a video in Shorty Low Projects when he was beefing. So it's just like, people will look at Tip and be like, oh, Tip, you being a hypocrite, you contradicting yourself. But that's what you do when you grow. Like Nikki Giovanni said, if you're not contradicting yourself, you're not growing.
Does T.I. have a banger like Game Over?
Man, shut up.
Honestly.
Yes!
I don't think
a million of them.
Flip. Flip, 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 flip,
game over.
A million of them.
Yo, that shit went, though.
Yeah.
That's how you sing.
What they want? Cool. Flip, 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 game over.
Nah, Game Over was dope. It wasn't one of my favorites, but it was dope. It was dope.
What's your favorite song ever?
Ever?
Yeah.
That's a hard question, bro.
I got my favorite rap song ever.
What's your favorite rap song ever?
Forget it. The name of it. But I know it if I tell you.
What is it?
It's, Lil Duval's friend. He's an Atlanta dude. God, man, what's his name?
Can't be that good.
They're like in his house or something like that. And they're in the kitchen and someone's like cooking up some like eggs and shit.
Oh, wait, what's the song about though? Because I thought you were going to say.
Young Dro. I'm cleaning this shit. I'm about to show the lead in this bitch. Yeah. Oh, I love that song. That's my favorite song, dude. Young Dro.
Show the lean. That's a great record.
Thank you, show the lean.
That's a great fucking record.
Me and my friend made the dance to it.
I love that shit.
Y'all made the dance to what?
Before the music video came out, made that dance.
What? Show the lean?
Yes.
Shoulder Lean. Shoulder Lean, one of the greatest hip hop songs.
Shoulder Lean's a great record.
That's a great record.
It's a great fucking record.
Shoulder Lean. They need
a
remix.
See you bounce left, right to left, and let you
shoulder. But if that's if they did a flip remix, if they did a Game Over Shoulder Lean remix though,
Lean over. No. That would be a good record for get people off Lean.
Lean over.
People off that fucking opioid.
You could be progressive with hip hop too, man.
I was gonna say too, the Ticketmaster.
What about Ticketmaster?
They're gonna require concert goers to pass COVID tests before attending.
Ooh, really? Is that the case? Your boy might be out on the road again then. Might be out on the road.
I heard about that.
Should we do some Ask Idiots?
Let's do some Ask Idiots. Let's do some Ask Idiots, guys.
You want to do an ad real quick? It's mid-rolls.
All right, let's talk about ExpressVPN. Did you ever see The Social Dilemma on Netflix? I loved it. Okay, in the documentary, tech insiders explain how social media is engineered to exploit users' data for profit. They call it surveillance capitalism. I'm cool with normal capitalism, where I'm a willing participant in the transaction, like every time I go to the store to buy food. But when my data is being harvested so tech billionaires can get even richer, that's where we got to draw the line. And that's why I put a layer of protection around my data with ExpressVPN, okay? Every time you use the internet, big tech companies, they mine your data by tracking your searches, messages, and video history. But when you run ExpressVPN on your device, it hides your IP address, which websites can use to personally identify you. That makes your activity more difficult to trace and sell to advertisers. You still need to be careful with what you share on social media, but ExpressVPN can make your web browsing more anonymous. ExpressVPN also encrypts 100% of your internet data to keep you safe from hackers and prying eyes. Many VPNs slow down your internet, but not ExpressVPN. It's incredibly fast and easy to use. Just tap one button and you're protected. So if you don't like the idea of tech companies exploiting your personal information, then visit expressvpn.com/idiots right now and you can get 3 extra months of ExpressVPN for free. That's expressvpn.com/idiots to protect your data. Go to expressvpn.com/idiots to learn more. Now back to the show. Let's get into some motherfucking Ask an Idiot. And then it's time to go. What we got, Taylor Gang?
Baze. I don't know how to say their name. But they want to know, will 2021 be as bad as 2020?
I don't think 2020 was bad.
Or will things get better?
I don't think 2020 was bad. No,
that's good.
I think everything is God's will. I think everything, it's not about thinking. Mm. Everything in 2020 went the way everything in 2020 was supposed to go. Right. You may not realize that now. But you're going to look back and you're going to realize, okay, that happened for this reason. This happened for that reason. 2020 went exactly the way it was supposed to go. Right. Even when you can chalk up all the death, that was, if you believe in, you know, the divine, or you just believe in everything being God's will, like you got to take the so-called good with the so-called bad, right?
Yeah, so, like things aren't good or bad. They just are when it
they
comes
just
to-
are. That's how I feel. And I, like 2020 is like, for me, you can't unsee what you've seen over the past year.
Yeah.
And so America really has, not even just America, the world has a great opportunity to correct itself.
Yeah. Yeah. I think 2021 is actually going to be great because a lot of times, like, how we look at something is based on perception. And we thought 2020 was so horrible perception-wise. So now we experience all those things that were awful. And anything that is not that is going to feel great.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that we got an amazing year to look forward to. And 2021 might not even be close to as dope as 2019. But since it's coming right off the back of 2020, we're going to really appreciate it. So, yeah, I think we're all going to have a good year.
And the wild thing about perception, right, it's so funny to me. All of these diehard Democrats, they act like the end of the world was happening. Trump was in the White House.
Yeah,
Trump's not in the White House. Now our trauma has been resolved. We can get to healing.
Yeah, yeah.
No, the fuck we can't. They got a million MAGA march this weekend.
Yeah.
70 million people voted for Trump. Yeah. Ron DeSantis is like, shoot looters.
Yeah,
you know what I mean? And they can't tell the difference between looters and protesters now.
Uh-huh.
What the fuck are y'all talking about? America is America. We got a lot of work to do.
Work ain't done.
And if you're thinking about 2020 and all of that shit, they say what they say, hindsight is 2020 and all that.
Yeah.
Well, y'all motherfuckers better look behind you. All right. And start seeing really clear what the fuck is going on in America. What's happened over the past 11 months. Ain't shit changed.
Right.
Except for the administration.
That's right.
That's it. So get the fuck out of here. I thought 2020 was great. I think 2020 is going to go down as probably the most pivotal year in the year that started a new reconstruction era in this fucking country.
Ooh.
I really feel that way.
Ooh, okay.
Okay.
So if you look at it like that, it's great. If it sparked a change that like makes millions of people's lives way better, then it's amazing.
And if you like, once again, everything is God's will. You can't believe in God when things go good,
and then not believe in Him when things go bad.
Yeah. Like, you know, you got to accept it as His will. Everything in 2020 absolutely happened for a reason.
Okay, well, connected to that, Ed Martinez wants to know, If there was one thing you could change about America, what would it be?
One thing I could change about America? I'd like it to be a little warmer in New York.
Oh, global warming's going to give you that, baby.
Nah.
You ain't got to worry about that. Climate change is going to give you that.
Honestly, if there's one thing I could change in America, I would love I'd love an environment where like Americans felt secure. And that's regardless of like who you are. Like I don't want anybody to exist in this country and feel this sense of fragility, you know? Like I don't want you to think you're gonna get shot by the cops. I don't want to think you're not gonna be able to afford your rent. I want to think you're not gonna be out of a job. Like it'd be great. Not everybody doesn't have to be a millionaire here. That's not how this shit is set up. But it'd be great if people with all the luxury that we have and all the money that we have and technology, it'd be great if people didn't think if they're gonna make it next month.
I wonder,
that'd be cool.
I wonder, I don't even know if this will work. I just would like to see this eliminate prejudice. Mm-hmm. Right? And the reason I said prejudice, because prejudice covers it all. Mm. Racism, sexism, homophobia, you know, transphobia, Latinophobia. There's anything that's different than you, you just like if you get rid of prejudice, I think people would look at America as an even playing field. You know what I mean? Because people come here because they want that equality. Equality is we're going to be treated equally and we're going to be able to, you know, have the same opportunities as the next person.
Yeah.
I think you get rid of prejudice, you level the playing field.
Yeah.
You make America safer and better for everyone. Everybody gets the same amount of opportunity. I don't know if that'll work. I just, you know.
Yeah, dude, I would love to get people to understand each other, man. That maybe that's what I would want to change because I think we all agree, like you were saying at the beginning of the episode, like we all agree on the main core values and issues. So how do I get people to talk to each other or at least understand each other? Mm-hmm. Because when you're not leading with your like with your opinions, right? Like when Americans meet each other outside of like political rallies, when we just meet each other at Walmart or we're just playing a pickup basketball game, we're actually pretty nice to each other,
man. Hell yeah. Like, common ground.
Common ground. And also, like, if there's one thing those, like, Borat movies actually show, is it like, Americans are pretty nice to weird people that are just, like, Borat's trying to take advantage. You know what I mean? Like, Borat's, like, trying to take advantage, like, make people look stupid. But most Americans are like, yeah, I'll help you out, dude. Like, I'll help you, even though you're kind of, like, doing this weird shit to me. So we're kind of nice to each other. If I could just get people to believe or, like, help people understand that, like, it's not a battle of good versus evil that the media wants to portray because they can make money off of it. But we kind of all agree on the same goals. We just have different ways of getting there.
We got different biases.
And we have different biases. But like, if I could do that, man, that would be the number one thing I would change. I'd love for people to stop viewing their opposition as evil. Because once you think someone's evil, there's no compromise with
none.
Yeah.
None. What you got, Taylor Gang?
Biggs 1904 wants to know, do you guys think that there could be another civil war?
Nah. It'll be race wars. I mean, not even race wars. It'll just be like, it'll be the left versus the right. It'll be people who think their values, conservative and support for Trump is one, and people who support the Democrats the other. It'll be that.
Yeah.
I don't think it'll be a civil war.
Life's too good still.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like, we still want to play PlayStation 5.
I just got to Xbox yesterday, baby. Salute to Xbox. Xbox sent me an Xbox yesterday. Yo, Blockboy JB is so funny. Blockboy JB said PlayStation is for gay guys.
Yeah, I saw that.
Because of the rainbow flag on it. Yeah. And that shit is so funny to me.
And then he tried to like walk it back a little. He's like, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with that, but...
If I was PlayStation for Pride Month, I would put out the gay station. And like literally... I'm serious. And literally let it be a limited edition PlayStation that is fully... rainbow flag colored.
Rainbow.
Fully rainbow flag colored. Put out a limited edition. 100 copies, 500. That shit will sell like hot fucking cakes, yo. And when you turn it on, the pride flag comes up and it says that gay station. You know how PlayStation. I'm serious. This shit would kill.
Okay. Well, transition into that. Last question.
Yeah.
Okay.
Would you rather eat a homeless man's butt or suck a female's toes with food?
Yeah, man. Listen, you know, as always, if you listen to this podcast and you think we're smart, you think we're intelligent, you think we're brilliant, you're absolutely right. If you listen to this podcast and you think we're just a couple of idiots who don't know shit, you're right too. It's the Brilliant Idiots Podcast. Thank you for listening.
The toes.